Speaking of exciting,
I am exciting.
Hi. Did anybody have fun last weekend? Is anybody tired from last weekend? Did anybody get punched last weekend? Anybody wish they got punched last weekend, you know? Man, it was, I wanted to thank you a lot for everything that you gave in finances and in time. I'd like to know, I'd like, how many know that if you're going to give something of time or money, you probably ought to invest it and then expect a return on your investment? Does anybody just want to spend their life or spend their time or spend their money? No, I don't, right? I want to invest my life. So when I invest my life, what can I expect in an investment? A return. So I'd like to give you the return today, if you would allow me to do that. At the festival, a lot of things happened. I'm going to share with you a few of them, then I'm going to tell you the most important one at the end. The first thing is, there were a lot of kids who gave their lives to the Lord this weekend. See, you would think that that would be the most important thing, wouldn't you? Now, I normally, as a Christian, would have thought that that would be the most important thing. But to him, that's a result of the most important thing. Yes? See, they got saved. Hundreds of kids got healed emotionally, physically, spiritually. A lot of kids got delivered from things that they used to be tormented by. Hundreds. But what is the... what is the most important thing is that they all were loved. I don't know if all of you have spent, you know, as much time as I have in the Word. Some of you have spent way more time than I have in the Word. But he says this. He says, you can have words of knowledge. You can prophesy. You can speak in all kinds of languages. You can preach. You can see people get healed. You can see people get saved. But if you don't have love, it's just noise. That's exactly what he says. It's just noise. Now, how many know I Matter is all about noise? We are all about noise. But the beauty about it is noise is not the reason. Unconditional love is the reason. I would like to propose to you that even noise can be used when the motivation is love. Isn't that what we just heard? Without love, it's just noise. But all that stuff that's just noise actually is used by God for amazing things when love is attached to it. It's true. It is true. It is true. How do I know it's true? Because the Bible tells me so. I learned that in Sunday school. I want to talk to you today. We're launching a brand new series called Experiencing God. And I don't know anybody who's gotten married. I don't know anybody who's ever gotten into a relationship, a friendship. I don't know anybody who's ever accepted Christ that didn't do it for this reason. They actually wanted to have a relationship. How many of you, before you began a relationship, you started talking to the person that you ended up being in a relationship with? Did it start that way? Okay. How many of you guys couldn't wait for those letters to come in the mail that smelled really good? Kelly? Come on. Come on. Okay, Wendy, did he send you letters that smelled really good? Okay. Welcome home, our friends from Canada. We're glad you guys are so back with us. I told him I was going to kiss him right on the lips when I saw him, but I guess maybe I won't do that right now because, you know, Wendy's there and, you know, it just would get messy, that kind of stuff. So it's greet each other with a holy kiss. That's the whole idea behind it. But what was I saying before I interrupted myself? Relationships, right, okay. So see, how it begins is that you might get a letter, you might get an email, you might get a text, but how many are glad that your relationship doesn't stop there? Yes? I'm so glad that I don't just have a relationship with the letters that Lisa gave to me, because I think they went through the flood and I don't know if we have them anymore. I'm so glad that the same thing is true about our Heavenly Father. The same thing is true about our Jesus. And the same thing is true about Holy Spirit. His intention is that we have an intimate, personal, genuine, authentic, unique relationship with Him where we're able to hear in a language that we understand. And He is able to hear our hearts in a unique way as a father would with any of his children. Isn't that, I mean, that's, to me, that's very special. And it's so special to Him that He was willing to give up His most prized possession so that He and I could have that. He purchased it by sacrificing His Son, paying the price that I deserve to pay so that I could actually spend eternity beginning now, not when I die. I could begin spending eternity with Him right now, right here. That I could actually experience something that is meant for me while I'm alive, not just when I die. See, some people think that death produces salvation. The reality is, it's not death that produces salvation. Your salvation doesn't begin when you die. Your salvation begins at the moment that you have an encounter with Jesus. That's where it begins. So, my thought was, because I think that in our culture, how many know that our culture has become very academic driven? Would everybody agree? There's not even a thought. There's not even a thought in people's mind that you got to get an education, you know, you got to go to college, and you got to get a good job, and you got all those things, and then you retire, and then you die. That's our plan. And hopefully you make a lot of money and get a lot of toys, because he who dies with those toys wins. That's what I've heard. I've seen bumper stickers. But I think that there's something actually greater to live for than the toys. I like toys. Ask my wife. Christmas is my most wonderful time of the year. And I buy my children everything that I want. It's a great option. It's a great option to have. So I'm not against toys. What I'm saying is, though, if I begin to live for my toys, then I've missed out on something because there's something greater than my toys. So, I'm finding that this stuff in the kingdom is so amazing because, like, it didn't make sense to me that I should actually give away something to get something greater. Like, it doesn't make sense to me that I should give my money away in order to actually have it returned to me in a greater abundance. It doesn't make sense that in order for me to get love in my life, that I actually have to give love away. See, a lot of people come to church and say, people weren't very friendly to me. When the reality is when we come into a church, when we come to our gathering, we have an assignment to actually move towards somebody in relationship, because if we're always dependent on somebody coming towards us, we'll miss out on a lot of things in life. I have had some amazing things spoken over my life, and I've had some amazing invitations. One was, I pulled into a church parking lot. Wow, I'm almost out of time already. Awesome. I am going to go fast because I'm hungry. I don't know about you, but I am a hungry child. So let's get this thing done. But I pulled into a parking lot and I saw this lady right here in the front row on the stage, and God said to me, everybody listen to me? God said to me, oh, see, there he is. You should be in one of those white coats around the back of his friend. He's hearing voices. God said to me, this is your wife. Now, she's 12 years younger than me. Come on, somebody. I mean, I'm in full agreement with you, Lord. I'm in full agreement with you right now. She's pretty. She's cute. She's talented. And he just said she's going to be my wife. So what happens when you get a confidence when the Lord's speaking to you? What happens? Yeah. What happened was I got a strut about me. And I walked in, Rico Suave, to Lisa, and I go, hey, you, me, you know, we were an item. I didn't say that. I just said, hi. And she went, I said, hi, I'm Scott. And she goes, oh, hi. And she walked away from me. No, sometimes when God tells you something, sometimes how many know that the world sometimes doesn't line up with it? It wouldn't be, I thought, listen, if God told me something, shouldn't he have told her? I'm just thinking, you know, that might be. But he hadn't at that point. Now, I'm going to say something. I don't know if he would have told her unless I actually obeyed him and did what I was told. So the first thing I did was I took a month off and I said, okay, it's either hormones or it's God. Sometimes it's both. But I loved the fact that I took a break and I said, okay. And I took 30 days off and I said, if that sensation, if that voice is still there, I'm going to go ahead and pursue her. I did. I invited her in to write a song. We've been writing a song ever since. Got married 7 months later. Bang. There we go. All right. We have a couple trophies as a result. Levi and Ariel. And then in the midst of that, we've had 42 other ones that have lived with us since that time that we've raised up and called our own. And they're all doing well except for two. And I'm hoping someday they will. So for me, I can't say for her. But for me, I'm glad that I listened to his voice. Because her no, if it was stronger than his yes, then I wouldn't have pursued her. Then there was this thing, he called me into the ministry. Now, how many know, you know, a call in ministry, and I was like, come on, it's like, that's a great call. I want to be a pastor like you. Really? No. My son Nate just got the call in his life to go into the ministry. He's a state trooper. And I told him, son, run as fast as you can. But I said, no, I was delighted. But what I want to say is this. When I heard the call that she was, when I heard the invitation, she was my wife. When I heard the call into the ministry, see, the Lord called me in the ministry. I got set in. I preached. There was 120 people here, and I gave them my best. I was poured out, I'm fresh out. Gave them my best. I preach to 120 people, and I'm stoked because I'm thinking they're going to bring all their friends back next week. Next week came, and there was 12. Again, I said, God, are you sure that you did the right thing? Then what we had is a board then. All of them decided, we got to get rid of this guy because we got to get rid of this guy. He's destroying the place. And I walked by, and I heard them. Now, how many know that when you are just new into something, you've just gotten the keys to something, you don't even know how to turn the lights on in the place, and you have a whole bunch of people saying, we got to get rid of him. How many know when you don't want to be here to begin with and somebody's saying you want to get rid of him, the first thing is, I'm out of here. I'm going to go back being an engineer because I make lots of money and I had a 401k plan. Oh, and health insurance. But I chose to walk away from that to do this in the midst of everybody leaving and a board that didn't want me. So I just want to say, if you don't hear well, then you won't obey well. See, because if the voices in the world are stronger than his voice, if people's opinions are stronger than his opinion, you'll never obey him because you'll be obeying that which is counter him. And I want to tell you something. Every time the Lord invites you into something, the enemy is going to invite you away from it. And I'm going to tell you, just straight up, his voice, the enemy's voice, is way louder than God's. Unless you have the filters. Does that make sense? Boy, I'm really glad that air kicked on. How many of you are in agreement with me? Okay, thanks. So I want to take the word because this is a big deal. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Some of us read the word and never hear. I'm going to teach you in this series how to read the word until you do hear. I don't think you should read the word chapter by chapter. I think you should read the word hearing by hearing. Does that make sense? In other words, spend the time in the word until you hear his voice, and then stay there. If you hear his voice in one verse, stay there until he's done talking. Am I making sense? Some of us, I love the fact that we have all these different programs that you can get through the Bible in 1 year. I love the fact that we have people that read the New Testament like every 2 months, every 3 months. I think saturating yourself with the Word of God is amazing. But can I tell you something, what it's intended for? The Word of God is designed for you to read it so that you can hear his voice and get to know the one who wrote it. It's not designed to just go through it and say, check, 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 I got it done. But if I can read this and have it actually affect change on me, that's going to benefit me more than it will if I just blow through it and it has no effect on me whatsoever. Does that make sense? So I'm just saying, if you're going to have one or the other, I would sooner you take your time and digest this over your whole life. Well, this is going to sound weird. I don't even care if you don't finish it all the way through once. I think if you stayed in the Gospels even, you would do really well. If you live the Gospels. Does that make sense? I think Jesus put it this way. I think there were, how many laws are there, Dr. Bob? 600 and what? Huh? 619 plus the Ten Commandments. We've got 629 rules to follow. How many, how you doing with that? Everybody doing okay? How many even know 692 rules? If you don't know the rules, how are you going to follow them? How many know that if you break one of the rules, you've broken them all? And you don't even know what they are. We are in trouble, folks. We are in trouble. How many know all the Ten Commandments? You can quote them right now. Just 10. How many know 10? Okay. And if you break just one of those, you're in trouble. Oh, okay. So how many are glad that we no longer live under the law? Then why do we try to keep other people to it? Ooh, I don't know. How many are really appreciate people being gracious to you? Then why do we have a problem giving people grace? How many really appreciate when you're forgiven of things you messed up then? Then why do we have a problem giving other people forgiveness? See, this is a big deal to Jesus, and Jesus simplified it like this. Hey, he goes, hey, everything hangs on this. Everything, all the law, all the prophets, all the stuff hangs on this. Two things. What is it? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love each other. As yourself. So loving yourself could be important, couldn't it? Why? Because you don't love yourself, how are you going to love them? Oh, how can you love yourself unless you actually know the one who is love? His name is God. So you might be doing the wrong thing with yourself. It may not be love. Therefore, you're giving the wrong thing to other people. The only way you can actually love is to be loved by him and let him demonstrate it towards you. How many are glad that God just didn't say he loves you, but he actually demonstrates it? How many of you know that until you experience love, you really don't know what love is? I want to know what love is. Come on. Everybody just sing. I want. Okay. So my goal, my hope is that we can take this word and see in the word where it was his idea to actually encounter him and experience it him. It's not some crazy guy's idea. I'm not saying I'm not a crazy guy. I am a crazy guy. What I'm saying is it's not my idea to be crazy about this. Okay? Everybody okay with that? Okay, good. Okay, let's turn to our Bibles then. John 17:3. How many want to know what eternal life is? Okay. I mean, if we're going to have it, we ought to know what it is. John 17:3. Turn me there real quick. And I got 10 minutes. 10 minutes to a burger. John 17:3 says, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you sent. When you see Jesus, you see the Father. I don't know what God looks like. Yes, you do. Look at Jesus. How do you look at Jesus? Read about him in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You'll figure out who he is. Once you figure out who he is, you'll be able to see who God is. Well, I don't know what God's will is. Yes, you do. Read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you'll actually see what God's will is, because his will was demonstrated and manifest in his son, Jesus. What's his heart like? Look at Jesus. What's really important? Look at Jesus. I feel like I've been spending a lot of time in the Gospels, again. I feel like we have somehow made the Gospels filter through the rest of the Bible. And I would just like to propose to you, I believe we have to take the whole Bible and filter it through the Gospels, because Jesus is perfect theology. If you want to know what God is like, look at Jesus. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father except for by him. He said, I pray that all of you are one, like the Father and I am one. I pray that you'll allow me to live inside of you, because the Father and I are one. I'm in him, he's in me, I'm in you. Let me be in you so that we can be one, so that you and the Father can be one, so that you can be sons and daughters of God, because all of creation is waiting for you, sons and daughters, to be revealed to God. Not people that go to church, not people that are just good. He wants sons and daughters to be revealed, and all of creation is waiting. Why? Because when we come into our identity, all of creation is going to come up into its identity, its original intent that God intended for it to be. And everything that we're struggling with in this culture and in this world will be fixed in the moment that we actually function in our identity and begin to impact the world because of who he is, Christ in us, the hope of glory. It is. That's just how, that's the hope of goodness. Why is there not goodness in the world? The salt's not there. Why is it not flavored right? Why is there so much darkness? Because we were meant for darkness, and our light is not just a light that's hidden under a bushel, and it's not just this little light of mine that shines, but we've got a light inside of us that burns, that a wet blanket can't stop it, because it will burn right through the wet blanket, or the red blanket, whichever one you want to burn. That's how we should be. Listen, could anybody put Jesus' light out? What did we sign up for when we became Christians? We wanted to learn a book. When we signed up to be a Christian, did we want to learn principles? Did we want to learn discipline? Did we want to learn how to go to church? Did we want to learn how to have a good life? Did we want to learn how to make a budget? Do we want to learn how to, I mean, what's the reason that we signed up to be a Christian? The early Christians got identified as Christians, which means Christ-like, because the early Christians lived like Christ. Now, people are called Christians that don't live anything like Christ. So why doesn't the world want to be like Christians? Because the Christians aren't actually being Christ-like. Our house intends to change that. We do. I think there's a lot of houses that intend to change that. Because I'm going to tell you something right now. Todd White was here this weekend. How many of you that heard Todd White actually wanted to get saved again? I heard him. I'm like, oh my goodness. I forgot that's actually who I am. I forgot that I actually see Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. Why? Because if you looked at Paul and you saw Christ, people actually wanted to be like Paul. Why? Because Paul was like Christ. When I saw Todd, I was like, oh my goodness, that I forgot, Jesus, what you looked like. And when I saw him, I was like, wow. I remember now. I remembered what I signed up for was, I want to be like you, Jesus. That's what I signed up for. I want to walk in the same passion, in the same love, in the same vigor, in the same genuine, authentic, like I'm just fully bought in. I want to walk in a fully bought in life just like you did. That's what I want. And guess what? That's actually what he wants for all of us. Not to just, you know, not just the good. He doesn't want you just to be good. He wants you to be God. Oh, that's strong. I can't be God. Pastor Scott, this Christian thing is so hard. No, can I tell you something? This Christian thing is impossible. It's impossible without him. But I think I read with him, all things are possible. So let me give you some more word. John 10:10. What's John 10:10 say? Anybody? What did the enemy come to do? Let me just read this. This is really important. How many know that God did not just waste any of his words when he wrote them down? He didn't waste any of them. 10:10, it says this. It says, the thief does not come. The thief does not come any other way except for what? To steal, kill, and destroy. That's the only way he comes. So whenever you're getting stolen from, who is it? He only comes that way. Who is it? When you're getting stolen from, your relationship, your finances, your children, your job, your thoughts, your joy, your heart, your peace, all, well, who's stealing from you? Satan is, the enemy. Steal, kill, and destroy. Anything on that level, that's the only way the enemy comes. You will always know when he's present because those things are happening. But then it says this, which I love. But I have come, right? But I have come, who is it? Who's I? It's Jesus. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. See, the problem is when the world looks at the church, they see us being stolen from, killed, and destroyed. Our relationships, our joy, our peace, our commitments, our covenants, all that stuff being stolen. And so if we're being stolen from, how are we any different than the world? But see, when they begin to see that Jesus came to give us life and to give it abundantly, and we actually move in that abundant life, then that's the thing being demonstrated. The world's going to say, I don't want a culture of death anymore. I want a culture of life. See, he came to give us that. So why don't we have that? Because we believe the lie of the enemy that we actually come into agreement with the enemy to empower him to steal from us, to kill us, or destroy us. Anybody ever having any problem with complaining? Whining? Moaning? How about preferences? Anybody have any preferences? I got preferences. Pastor Scott, this Christian life is so hard. Why is God making it so painful? Why is he making it so difficult? I can tell you why. He tried to kill you and you didn't let him. See, because dead people can't feel anything. Yeah. And if you're dead to yourself, which, right, we all of us got baptized, right? Dead to ourselves, raised into what? New life. See, the life I now live is not my own, it is Christ. That's the life I now live. I live that life. And when I watch Todd and he says, I'm unoffendable. How many of you would like to know somebody that you can't offend? I tried to offend Todd all weekend long. I tried. And it's true. He's unoffendable. I'll tell you this. He offended me a few times. Anybody else get offended in here by those? How many of those? Sometimes, man, it's like, don't touch that. Don't touch that button. Don't touch that button. And all of a sudden you go, oh, ow, oh, ow, ow. Pastor Bob put it really well in our staff meeting. He goes, where are we going to go from here? Where are we going to go now? Well, where are we going to go? I mean, what? Like, everything just got. See, so God's not trying to make your life difficult. He's just trying to kill you. The beautiful thing about it is the reason that you're still struggling is because you haven't died. Do you know, Jesus modeled it great on the way to the cross. Do you know what I hated about him going to the cross? Was all the pain that he was in while he was going to the cross. I kept saying, Brendan, will you remember, man? I kept saying, we're in the theater watching The Passion of the Christ. Lisa's sitting next to me, and they're beating on him, they're stabbing him, they're kicking him, and his mom's over on the side, and he's just constantly, you see the pain all over his face. I'm going, just die, God, just die. Just die, because I knew once he died, it'd be done. Can I tell you something? He feels the same way about us. You get to the cross and just get it finished. Because the pain that you're enduring is not necessary because he paid it for you. Just accept that and take upon yourself that instrument of death called the cross, and so you can follow him and follow him with full life abundantly. That's what he has, man. That's what he had, man. We sat there that like we got done watching The Passion of Christ, and we go, 30 of us standing in the theater, we're going, we couldn't even talk to each other. Can I tell you something? That film was probably only about 10% of what actually happened. What he endured for you and I. You know how valuable I feel when somebody does something for me? That's my language of love. But when Jesus did what he did, do you know how valuable you are? Do you know how important you are? Do you know how for you he is? And listen, if while we were yet sinners, he would do that for you, what is he doing now that you're a saint? How does he feel about you as a son, as a daughter? Is there anything that God, see, if God is for us, who can be against us? Do we believe that? Are we walking in that? Are we enjoying the life of that? And I think we saw it modeled with Todd White and with Jake Hamilton. And by the way, they said, you guys are amazing. They said, you're amazing. And they love being here. And they both said this to us. anytime we invite them to come back, they're coming because they want to be around people like you. That's what they said. So way to go, Dan. I'm going to close with this because it's 12:15. We're going to go on this journey of experiencing God. I want to tell you how it starts, and I want to tell you why it has to start this way. God is a supernatural being. You can't understand spiritual things about God without being spiritual. You can't be spiritual unless you actually have His Holy Spirit living inside of you. That's all. It's pretty simple. So what I want to do is I want to show you in the Word real quickly, and you might want to write this down in case you ever wanted to lead anybody else to Christ that you come across. You might want to write this down in your Bible in the back. This is where I have it in the back of my Bible. I've got it in my notes here. But I want to tell you, here's where it starts. If you want to have an encounter or an experience with God, here's what you have to do. Romans 3:23 says this. We put it up real quick. Wow, my clothes are getting big on me. Romans 3:23. All right. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. How many people have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Well, now, we've really done really a good job at recognizing sin, but how many know that we also fell short of the glory of God? In other words, we fell short of His goodness. See, I used to be all consumed with sin, and I forgot the fact of I really was never experiencing the goodness of God because I was falling short of it. How many know that when you're saved, you no longer have to fall short of His goodness? See, as a saved person, I have access to all of His goodness, and I want, and see, if you're experiencing His goodness, you're going to want everybody else to experience that goodness. How many know that I was a sinner saved by grace, but I'm no longer a sinner? Because sin no longer has dominion over me. I am now a child of God. I have His DNA. So sin doesn't have ownership over me. My sin nature is done. Done. Why? I'm a new creation. All things have passed away. All things have become new. Romans 6:23, the reason I was able to not be a sinner is because of a free gift He gave to me. See, the wages of sin is death. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. How many believe that? So it's a free gift. He paid for it for everyone, and everyone, watch this, if I give you my Bible, I can give you my Bible, but if you don't take it, you don't have it. He's given us a free gift. Yeah. All we got to do is receive it. Romans 5:8 says this, who bought the gift? He did. Jesus paid the price once and for all, for all y'all. He paid the price, and not only for you, but for everybody in the world. He paid the price for everybody in the world. All they got to do is receive it. Everybody getting this? How many believe this so far? Everybody believe this so far? It's the Bible? We believe? Okay. So then, once I understand that Jesus paid for it, Romans 10:9-10 says this. Confess with your mouth, that if you confess with your mouth that the Lord Jesus, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Will you or won't you? You will be saved if you do what? Confess Him with your mouth and believe in your heart. I want to propose to you, you can confess all you want. If you don't believe in your heart, it does you no good. You also can believe in your heart and not confess it, and it does you no good. Oh, Pastor Scott, I believe it. I believe it. I just don't want to talk about it. I just believe it. I'm just going to tell you something. Confession is good for the soul. With confession, confess your sins one to another that you may be healed, right? There's something about the declaration. There's something about the confession. There's something about sharing it in whatever language that you can. Well, what if you can't talk? Write it down. There's a confession that has to be made that He is who He said He is. Because when you declare it, right, in that declaration, now manifestation comes behind it. What's in your heart has to come out. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Making sense? So now it's not just, well, Pastor, I believe in God. Well, the devil believes in God and he trembles. Believing in God is not enough, y'all. There's a walking and a confession, this is who He is. And you're bought in. Well, Pastor God, I can't get past that. Here's what I'm going to tell you. Your mind can't believe or know everything that your heart can. You're going to have to trust that your heart has the ability to believe things that your mind can't. Because his love is greater than our mind can comprehend. His peace that he gives us surpasses our understanding. So you have to say, God, I don't understand it all, but I'm willing to give up my understanding so I can receive everything that you have for me. And I know my heart can be increased enough, have a capacity enough to believe all these things that you're saying, because your faith, your spirit, man, is going to come live where? In our heart. And then my mind can get renewed so I think like Christ did. But it's not first. It's after. Romans 10:13 says this, ask whoever calls on the name of the Lord, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Once that happens, you become a person that has the Spirit of God. If you actually believed in your heart, confessed in your mouth, now you're able to, because anybody get frustrated with your Christian walk? Bored? Do you feel, I wrote some of these things down, are you tired? Are you confused? Are you jealous? Are you reevaluating everything? Do you question everything? Are you disillusioned? Have your past experiences taught you something that isn't him? See, you can't understand spiritual things. You can't understand him. You can't understand his ways unless you're a spiritual person. And the way you become a spiritual person is you have him. You say, I'm not getting it, God, but there's something in my heart that's believing, although my mind is in conflict with it. My reasoning is in conflict with it. People's opinions around me is in conflict. But there's something, I'm drawn by something that I can't identify. I can't put definition to it, but there's something inside of here that just keeps working. And I gotta find out, I gotta let this thing go and let you, give you at least a chance, because I've given everything else a chance. I believed everybody else's opinions. I've let a lot of people tell me what is and what isn't, but I haven't really given you that full place to let you speak directly to me, because I'm even afraid to hear you. But can I please? I want to trust you with all that I am. Yeah. And if you can get there, guys, if you can just get there, if you can just say, man, I'm scared to jump out. I'm scared to take this leap. I'm scared about what other people think. If you can let that fear go and let his love that is perfected move that fear out away from you, then jump into his arms. And I'm going to tell you, you will never, ever, ever wish you hadn't. Because once you taste and see that the Lord is good, you're going to want more. Because you had fallen short of the glory of God. He wants you to overwhelm you with his glory. And it comes this way. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? And I do this because I respect you. I respect you. I'm not going to ask anybody to come to this altar. I'm not going to ask you to dance or run around, or we don't even have chandeliers. You can't swing from them. So I'm not going to ask any of that stuff. What I am going to ask is that right now you just get serious. You just get serious with your Father. And he's provided something for you to have a personal experience, relationship, life with him. And so if you trust even a little bit my hearing, but if you trust his voice, and the Holy Spirit may be saying to you, hey, you know, what he's telling you is true. If you're getting that, if you're sensing that, don't harden your heart and don't say no again. The world will always leave you empty. Past experiences will always leave you empty. But even when things don't go your way, if you're holding on to his hand, he walks you through those valleys, those shadows of death. And it's in holding his hands that you don't have to fear anything. No matter how much of a struggle it is, how difficult it is, how much it doesn't make sense to your mind, if you can get past that today, by laying down your life, you will get his. So if you want that, if you are okay with trusting him with your future, if you're okay with grabbing hold of his hand, if you're okay with him holding you like a loving father would, and some of you have been abused by fathers, and I break that off of you in Jesus' name, because that wasn't your heavenly Father. He adores you. He is for you. He would do nothing to ever hurt you. He gave his very best for you. So in the light of that, if you believe what the word has said, and if you would, right now, by the indication, no one's looking around, this is between you and the Father, say, Pastor Scott, I want you to pray for me and remember me. I want the genuine, authentic relationship with my Father through his Son, Jesus. listening to the Holy Spirit right now. I'm listening to the Holy Spirit as he's drawing me. I don't even understand any of this stuff, but I want to get to know him more. Would you indicate that right now, and with no one looking around, by raising your hand, whoever that is? Yes, 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 yes. Oh, you guys rock, man. So here's the deal. All the angels in heaven are applauding that right now. I want you to pray with me this prayer, not because it's a magical prayer, but I'm going to help you walk through like a mentor would, like a father would. I'm going to help walk you through like I would my own daughter, Ariel. I'm going to help walk you through that which is pleasing to his heart. So everyone, say this with me, just like I would for Ariel. Say this with me. Dear Jesus, I believe you are who you said you are. Father, thank you for the gift of your son. Say it again. Father, thank you for the gift of your son. I would like to invite him into my life. Thank you, Jesus, for receiving me. Now, Holy Spirit, come and infuse me. Love me. Teach me. Guide me. I give you my life. I give you my heart. I give you my family. I give you my relationships. I give you my children. And for the generations to come, today just changed everything. I have taken full responsibility, and I say yes with my whole heart to you, Jesus. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for being raised again. Thank you for living evermore. Now I trust you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, you may not feel anything, you may not sense anything, but I'm going to tell you what's coming next. You're going to begin to develop a hunger for getting into the Word and finding out about this person you just invited into your life. You're going to get a hunger, right? You're going to get a hunger to want to be around people, crazy people just like us, that actually kind of know him a little bit. But we're all getting to know him a little bit better. So you're going to want to be around people like that because you're going to want to be better. I know when I wanted to be a good baseball player, I'd hang around with guys like him because he's a good baseball player. When I want to be a good engineer, I'd hang around with guys like him because he's a good engineer. When you want to be a person passionate for Jesus, how many know hang around with Todd White, you might get a little passion going on. It's the same thing. Find people that are passionate about Jesus and emulate them. Here's the third thing. In your prayer life, it's not going to be the fact that you're learning what to say to him. You're going to learn how to hear him. We're going to teach you over this next few weeks what a lot of this stuff means. But here's the requirement for you now, okay? Notice that anybody come up here. It's not about embarrassing anybody, but here's the big deal. Today, find somebody and tell them what you just did. Find somebody. And secondly, find somebody in this house, in your life, that loves Jesus a lot. You're not going to find anybody perfect except for me. Okay, not me either. But find somebody that you can do life with and begin to travel with them, asking them questions. Find somebody to mentor you, somebody to coach you with the result of that. Because if you don't find it, if you don't hunger for it, if you don't desire it, then you're really not going to ever really want it. And you're not ever going to benefit from it. If we push it on you, it's not going to benefit you. But if you have a hunger for it, he said, those that are hungry, I will fill. Those that are thirsty, I will quench their thirst. Those three things are going to happen. Don't walk out this door and let the enemy rob it from you. What happened today has been by faith set solid. You'll never be more saved. You'll never be more redeemed than you are right now. Now what happens is you work out that marriage that just took place, just like when you got married and you said, I do. The rest of your life, you keep doing. It's the same way with salvation. You keep working it out and becoming more and more like him. Does that make sense? If you can't find somebody, ask one of the pastors, leaders around here. We will help you find somebody, or we'll do it ourselves. Why? If you're important enough for him to die, you're important enough for us to live. Does that make sense? We have some amazing, passionate people around here to help you do that. By the way, between the two services today, we're around 30 people that came into the kingdom. Let's just give him an applause today.
Come on.
Bless you, God. Bless you, God. Boy, it's always a good day when that kind of stuff happens.
Yeah.
We're glad you're here. Welcome to our family. We'd just love to love on you. We're going to take a moment, close this out, worship one more time. I'm sorry, I'm about 15 minutes late. How many know that somebody might have been worth that 15 minutes, though? Yeah, yeah. Let's stand one more time. Let's have a little bit of celebration. We're going to worship him one more time. And Pastor Bob, just close us out.
Can you bless you guys.